Turn to ban.
Game number four, what could be the final game in this best of five series to determine who is going to be going to the Dota Pit LAN Finals is about to start. The draft just now getting underway with myself, Capitalist, going to be joined by CCNC. CC, Secret's been looking pretty good in game number two and three. Do you think more of that just comes down to Team Secret? They just look like a better team, execution in the game, or do you think there's a bit of a draft lead for them as well?
I think there have been some slight draft leads, but Secret has also just been playing a lot cleaner, I think. More cohesive. They've known what they needed to do from the very beginning and like made sure they did that. Where Slipside, I feel like they have good team cohesion and they have good team fighting and spellcasting and stuff, but just less structured of a game and not really so sure about like having a plan of specific things they need to do in the game.
Do you think there's anything about Team Secret's drafts that you've seen so far in the three games that we've seen from them that stands out that you would like Flipside Tactics to deal with in one way or another, maybe a certain ban that needs to come out, or has the draft and playstyle from Secret been varied enough that you don't see any real obvious weaknesses?
I mean, mid one is typically their playmaker, their 10 seconds, the person remaining. That gets stuff done. He goes around, he makes the plays, he always comes to early fights, so maybe remaining. Trying a little harder to shut down him, but tried to do that in the game with the Earthstrider and the Batrider, and he just didn't die. He stayed super passive, played really well, had one CS. Really, like, as whenever you play mid in games where, you know, you have an Earthspirit just sitting there, having the mindset of being okay with having one CS is so hard. It's, like, really, really impressive that he was able to sit back and not die to any of those ganks.
It shows a lot of trust team in his team, right? Turn
to pick. Yeah, just knowing this isn't a pub, he doesn't have to 1v5.
Yeah. Flipside Tactics, they're going to go for the Drow Ranger first. Didn't work out for them last game. Team Secret, they're going to respond with Zane Bobing. They will. All right, which Bounty Hunter Flipside Tactics are like, all right, the laning phase went fine for us. We really should have been able to take control of that game better. We just made a couple of mistakes, right? They continue to push through after they pushed down that tier one tower, and they stayed in that off lane a bit too long. That was the first critical mistake. And then there was some Pekons that they shouldn't have allowed, like immediately following that fight, right? They swooped up and got the Dragonite. That should not be a kill that Team Secret should be able to easily pick up, but he was out of position. So apparently Flipside are feeling like, okay, we can have a repeat. We probably won't see the same exact drafts from both teams, but Flipside Tactics are at least going to be running a Drow Ranger strat, and it's going to be comboed with an Earthspirit.
Yeah, a little bit of a different take on the Drow strat this time. Earthspirit instead of the Chen, so less just run down buildings, more 5 seconds remaining. More trying to find kills and then snowballing that into the buildings afterward. So far from these two picks, reserve but time. Not too much you can draw from just these.
Yeah, maybe they're going to try and put a bit more pressure on the mid lane per your suggestion about keeping mid one down. Like they did in game number one, at least, when he was playing that Templar Assassin. Team Secret are going to once again ban away the puck, probably one of the classic heroes that pair up really well with a Drow Ranger. It's an aggressive hero that gives really good disables, a nice initiator, and on top of all of that, he wins his lane when he's got that Drow Ranger extra damage aura coming in.
It's also here you can put off lane and do quite well, especially versus heroes with, you know, really weak supports in lane, like the Wisp and the Bounty Hunter. Works very well with that, and you can also turn fights around. A hero that can rotate pretty easily. So if, you know, fights do go down, they can, you know, maybe once again make moves on mid one if they did have that. So all around, just a pretty good ban.
Do you think that, do you think they should run an aggro tri lane again to abuse the weakness of these supports that Team Secret are opening with? Or is there a different way that they can abuse a Wisp Bounty Hunter opening?
I'm not sure. They may do another tri lane, but the aggressive tri lane wasn't like really the issue that game. You know, they played it well. They got a bunch of kills. Everything was going well. It's just Team Secret, they made some mistakes and things sort of fell apart afterwards. So I think it sort of depends on what their other heroes are and what they want to do with those. But as of now, they definitely could go aggro tri lane again. Just feel like doing.
The Tidehunter and Storm Spirit are going to be our bans this time around. Flipside Tactics replacing... I can't remember what the ban was. They obviously banned Storm Spirit both times in a row, but this time, that pesky Tidehunter obviously forever had a huge impact in that last game. It was very disruptive to the Drow Ranger pushes. Every single time they had a Ravage, they contested the tower push that was happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ferev is very, very good on the Tidehunter. Probably one of the few people that picks that hero, you know, very, very frequently. He goes to Gush early on, plays a sort of a different style than most people, and it's very effective.
Oh, the Lifestealer. That's what it was. Flipside Tactics don't ban away the Lifestealer. I'm in favor of the Tidehunter, and Team Secret will get into their hands. So if they can get an offlaner that gets a pretty decent Blink Dagger timing, I'm thinking Axe, right? It's you've got that kind of, thanks to the jungle, a guaranteed Blink timer with the Infest. Or do you think Slardar is good enough in this game? A little less reliable on the Blink Dagger, but better synergy with the Lifestealer.
I'm not sure. They kind of lack lane push right now. Like, they have the Bounty Hunter. They get involved with the Lifestealer, so they may end up trying to pick a greedier offlaner, or not necessarily greedier, but a hero that can push out waves, a hero that scales with farm better, and have this Lifestealer get active early on with the Bounty Hunter, and have the offlaner play more of a farm-ish role. Because as of now, like, their only way they really can defend the towers is if they jump them beforehand. If they ever get to a tower, They can't just spam the waves, though, so they have to jump them and fight them. There's no spamming waves out at this point.
What offlaners can really do that for you? There's like Timbersaw, but what else?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I was trying to think. There's not really that much. So what they probably have to do is just play a very just jump people and have their mid be more of a farming hero and get lanes out again. Something like the Potom. That's probably what they're gonna have to do because. You know, like you said, there's just not really that many heroes that can farm from the offline shove out waves other than the Timbersaw, but Timbersaw versus Drow and Faceless Void seems quite bad.
Yeah, yeah. You obviously are going to have a real hard time in that offlane against that. Is there any chance we can see a Timbersaw mid? There's the Axe for Team Secret. Guaranteed Blink Dagger timing.
Another way to move the Lifestealer around, very good versus Drow. She kind of just kills herself.
Flipside Tactics, they got themselves the Faceless Void as their offlaner, potentially mid. We've seen, obviously, the Faceless Void can run kind of anywhere. Remaining. It means a hero that can survive if he is forced into a 1v1 against the Axe. If an aggro trialing comes out from Flipside Tactics, he doesn't immediately lose the lane and get pushed out, but he won't win out in CS, that's for sure.
Going for the Bane.
Ooh. Very rarely seen without a Morana, that's for sure. It's a rare enough support with Morana, and even rare without, but it does at least give you the control over the Lifestealer through Rage.
Yeah, sort of harkening back to the old Seven Mad days where they'd always pick Bane and Potom on Flipside a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
Versus the Lifestealer, you can sleep the Axe if he goes in, or sleep the person he jumps on to stop them from hitting each other, or from hitting the Axe. The grip always very good versus the Lifestealer, draining his mana as well, so if you can grip him, stop him from getting draining his mana so he can't rage, can also be very, very big.
So when he jumps in and calls, right, that 1 second of invulnerability stops them from attacking the Axe, right? Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know if the... Will they actually... It's like 2 seconds, right? The second of invulnerability is 1 second. If he does it right away, what do you think happens? Can he actually still have the rage go out after the invulnerability is his fade, and then what, somebody takes a nightmare to the face off of that?
I'm not sure.
Either way, the timing is obviously very specific and unlikely to happen. More likely that 1 second invulnerability will save a lot of damage from some of these allies. The last man coming out, we need some sort of mid for Team Secret and potentially a mid for Flipside Tactics. We'll have to see how the lanes match up. Team Secret got to ban away the Batrider, and Flipside Tactics waiting on their pickup. Team Secret, I guess... afraid of initiation, right? It's always important if you have a Lifestealer. As we saw from that Lifestealer Slardar game, you always want to be the ones setting the initiation, getting the jump on a hero and making a 4v5.
or at least being in a position to where you can save the hero they go into life, so it becomes sort of stranded.
Mm-hmm. Ember Spirit is a ban away. So a scaling mid doesn't have the greatest wave clear. You said that's still important. Do you have an idea for a mid hero yet for a secret?
The Storm Spirit is banned, so it's not, they may have actually gone for the Ember Spirit. He's played that in the past. Not too recently, but you know, reasonably recent. They may go for the Reserve Tinker. Sort of depends on what Flipside picks here. If they pick something that is too good at rotating with the Earth Spirit onto the Tinker and shutting it down early. Timbersaw's not great here. They may end up actually going for the Tinker. Is the Invoker still in the pool?
Is there any chance a more farming mid can be picked up like Alchemist, or is that just too slow against a Dura Ranger?
I think it sort of depends on what Flipside picks here for their mid, if the Alchemist can lane, right?
Yeah, that's true. 5 seconds remaining. Well, we'll know in 5 seconds anyway. Flipside Tactics going right down to the wire, and it's going to be a Queen of Pain, a very aggressive and active mid laner for Flipside.
Yeah, they're, once again, their lineup is very execution-based. Almost all of the heroes are burstable and call, so if they jump, then they can definitely take these fights. They have the damage to do it, but if the, you know, the Axe remaining. Ever calls Quap, that's sort of the issue with that hero. You make one mistake, and you just evaporate it, sort of like a Tinker. Remaining.
What else is appealing about this Reserve Queen of Pain? Time. We see the lane dominance, obviously, he's got Drone Ranger, he matches up really well against most mids, but what else is really appealing about a Queen of Pain? Because it's not a hero that's being picked up a whole lot.
I mean, it's another range tier, so you can attack into the Chrono. It's extra damage, you know, you can throw the ult into the Chrono as well, because they are sort of lacking damage in Chrono. They have a lot of disables, the Earth Spirit stuff, Grip, the Chrono, but not that much damage, so the Quapple gives them something to throw into the Chrono so they can actually, like, pick off people instead of just having a bunch of disables and no damage.
Mm-hmm. Well, our last pick for Secret is going to be a scaling mid in the Invoker, so Secret kind of looking like a lineup that is going to hit really hard in the mid game, but around that 15-minute marker, they're definitely going to need some space to be created by the Axe, Lifestealer, and Bounty Hunter combination. That, for me anyway, is really going to... That seems like very specific, right? If Axe needs his Blink Dagger and they need those rotations to be successful and start getting track kills, otherwise, they're going to be incredibly pushed in by Flipside Tactics in that 15 to 25-minute marker.
10 seconds remaining. Yeah, it's for sure. The Lifestealer rotated quite early on in the other Lifestealer game, so... You know, whenever he's level 6, he may not even wait for the armlet and just go gank around with the Bounty Hunter, try and make moves on this Drow Ranger. The Axe will probably start jungle, and they may look for some sort of timing where the Axe hits level 5, level 6, something like that in the jungle. The Lifestealer is 6, and the Axe TB's up top, sort of baits, and they do some sort of rotation with the Bounty Hunter. They may look for some move like that to be their first move while the Wisp maybe catches up, or the Invoker, you know, while the Invoker farms stuff with Sunstrike. So we'll have to see.
5-man smoke up by Flipside to start things off. Not going for the early TPs like before to try and get vision down. Puppy, he's already on his way with an early TP out and getting the very aggressive ward. Going to be able to see the rotations of perhaps the Bane. It looks like they managed to scout out Puppy and they will manage to get the dust on him. Nightmare him up. Surrounds the poor Puppy man. And beat him down before the dust expires. That'll be a free first blood for Roger.
Definitely a nice start for the Earth Spirit, getting us some early XP, get to his boots quicker, or the Windlace or whatever, so he can, you know, it's a little bit easier to hit the...
Alright, good luck. Secret... How do they want to actually set these lanes up? Are they? Because it's looking like they're going to actually put the Lifestealer and Wisp up at the top lane against the Drow and Bane. Is this intentional? Are they actually down to put the Lifestealer against a Drow Ranger lane just to be able to give the Axe the 1v1 against the Void? Or do you think this is a misguided attempt to dodge a Drow Ranger aggro tri-lane?
I think they actually might be trying to dodge. They could be just sort of sacking the Lifestealer a bit and relying on the Axe getting a quick Blink Dagger, but I don't know how well that goes. down on the bottom line, because if the Earth Spirit rotates, they can get kills and sacks if Void chips them down a little bit. So I'm not sure. This may be an attempt at dodging the lanes, but see how this top lane goes. A Bane Drow definitely beats a Lifestealer Wisp, so
yeah. For sure, two ranged heroes against a Lifestealer with Draw Ranger Aura. I'm just surprised, because the reason I asked that question, I didn't actually assume, hey, you know, you've got defensive tri lane, I thought in my head, and Axe would just go jungle if the tri lanes don't match up against each other. You know, that for me seems ideal, but we'll see if Secret rotate out of this top lane. If so, we know they're attempting to dodge. If not, if they actually stick through it, then that means they're just putting everything on Perev and saying, we really want you to get that Vanguard Blink Dagger nice and early, so we're going to sack a Lifestealer's farm pretty heavily to get you to that point.
Mm. And it's, you know, another benefit of that is the Bounty Hunter can help out more mid, as opposed to if they just put the Axe jungle and then did the Lifestealer with safe lane, they could put the Axe jungle and have the Bounty Hunter sap top lane, but this Invoker will be sort of left off dry, so he's still not having a great laning stage, but I guess that's the price they're paying.
The roll comes in, kick into the tier 1 tower. Tame My Wild's gonna take a lot of damage, Fairy Fire popped, but Tame My Wild easily stays alive, and Puppy is rather ineffective in comparison to that initiation of the Earth Spirit.
Yeah, he missed a roll a little bit earlier. They almost got the kill with the Shadow Strike tick as he was walking away, but not quite, and not picking up the kill. So Invoker, once again, that one CS number seems to be very magical for mid one.
He's gonna rotate up to the top lane. Not sure if they can really do anything with Lifestealer, Wisp, and a Bounty Hunter, but maybe they'll get one of the flipside heroes out of position, and MP will be able to close that distance. He's already getting close to Vanscore, but look where Roger's at. He ran back to the base, and TP's in. He might be able to turn this one around. Vanscore having a hard time. They're going to go straight for the Wisp. Should be able to get that kill, too. The roll misses, but Vanscore is getting away with a sleep on a Puppy. He'll get back to the Tier 1 tower. Pylai dies, still being hunted. Healing South up, and both supports will stay alive.
Out of this lane, definitely going pretty okay for Secret right now. The bot lane going really well for the Axe. Over 10 CS up, some of those neutrals, so not that good, but starting to cut the wave now. So behind the tower, farming this camp and farming the hard camp, just rinse and repeat. And it's just over time, just gonna start pressuring this Void. It's gonna run out of regen, maybe even threaten a kill.
Do you think the Earth Spirit's time would be better spent pressuring Ferev, or do you just kind of like leave Shotula out there and say, survive as long as you can, but there's not much I can do to help you?
Yeah, at this point, I think it's just, it's too late. There was maybe a small window if Shotula had some good trades where they could maybe do something, but at this point, he's just too tanky. He may even go for the Vanguard first. I find it slightly unlikely, but he is having a very good start, so.
Yeah.
So he's just a little too tanky to gank. It's my 900 HP, 3 armor, and the level 3 spin. There's really no way to gank him at this point.
Yeah, the only way you would go Vanguard in a game, because Blink Dagger timing is so important for the Lifestealer, right? But the only way you would go Vanguard in this game is just because you're going to get Vanguard so early, and you'll still be able to get a good timing on Blink. But we'll see if Rev actually chooses to go down that route. Oop. Almost gets the call after a double spin, which would have prevented Shashlo from healing it off with the time walk, but not quite quick enough on the fingers there.
Yeah, if he gets some like obscenely early Vanguard time. Oh, looks like he is going Vanguard. Alright, so gonna go for that.
This in some ways just puts more pressure on Ferev to actually take advantage of the safe lane he's being given, because it means he's not gonna be online quite as early. He won't be able to make an early rotation up the top or anything like that. And if he, you know, forbid he gets shut down a little bit. Oop, Tether gets Pylai Dai some distance, but a nice double kick will be able to nail and finish off Pylai Dai. MP even takes a couple of shots as he retreats as well. Bottom lane, call goes out. Sunstrike looks like it was a little bit too late. Shotlo heals it all off.
Yeah, I don't know. Don't know about going this Vanguard. This top lane is not going that well. It was going okay early on, but now with the Drow getting the treads, getting some more levels and precision aura, they're starting to get zoned out pretty hard, so only the brown boots right now. 14 CS on both him and mid one. So Sax is gonna have to get really farmed and just get the solo kill, so Perkoff the Vanguard and making it work.
Yeah, there's some farm for you. and just get a nice call. Gets the kill. Roger's going to have to back away from the top lane as Bounty Hunter is going to try and wrap around. Not going to give him the chance to catch that kill. Now that he's got Vanguard, do you think they should rotate the Lifestealer to bottom and Ferev can just start go jungling and doing Ancients now that he's got Vanguard?
Maybe. I think if they do rotate the Lifestealer down, then they'll stick the Axe in the top lane maybe and try and contest them there because they don't really have the damage to deal with a Vanguard hero right now. Not too sure. It looks like they're going to keep things the way they are, just have the Lifestealer deal with this. The only issue with rotating is that this Void actually starts to get some space and maybe a little bit more farm, whereas now this Axe is just going to continue to cut the waves and eventually get this bot tower. So I think they're going to leave them down here until he gets this bot tower.
Oh. He's not doing it the fastest right now because Shotzil has been able to pull every single time. The choice of an early headdress is helping out his sustain, but obviously the Axe is still able to fully control this lane. MP forced into a rage here at top lane as Seedoy continues to take third CS in the lane, 28-6, 37-18 on the Queen of Pain. Obviously with the Drow aura, she's having a pretty decent mid lane, but hasn't managed to pick up a kill just yet, and is going to try and rotate bottom. Shotzil's got the Chronosphere ready to go, Tame My Wild, he has an ult of his own, but can they actually take down the tanky Axe? They need a little bit of extra help. Vanscore is going to be here with a pure damage. They've got the ultimate ready to go. Ferev stuck inside the trees, but gets a little bit of a spin up against the Flipside Heroes that's just trying to kite this hero as best as possible, holding on to the disables to make sure there is no chance at a TP out. Shotzil brought low, but not low enough for a chop, and the Axe will eventually go down. It took them a while, a lot of resources being spent, but a worthy kill.
Yeah, he sort of got stuck in the trees there. I think if he just ran straight down, he probably would have lived, but Quap getting like three screams off, eventually chipping him down. He did throw the kitchen sink at him, but eventually getting him. The Quap didn't even have to use ult, actually, so still has that for any possible turnaround stop.
Yeah, it's all they use is the Chronosphere, and that's kind of, you want to use the Chronosphere as early as possible. This does leave Seedoy a little bit high and dry. The Bane isn't here to be able to save him, so Secret immediately try and get aggressive on him. Roger fails to get the turnaround kill onto Puppy, and it looks like he'll still die as well. Unable to have a roll for a few more seconds, and MP's just too fast with the tether to play Ring Around the Rosie against.
Yeah, that was a really, really nice rotation, realizing how much time they spent down there, multiple TPs, the Quap super low on mana, and no real way they can turn around top and just storming the Drow.
Yeah, at that point, if you're Seedoy, oh, Jesus. Okay, he's good, though. Can't dive the tier 1 tower when you're that low. MP will be forced back away. But when you make that kind of rotation, right, and you show that many heroes for that long, if you're the Drow Ranger, you kind of almost have to, like, jungle at that point, because the enemy team's just gonna beg to dive you. Like,
yeah, there's almost no other move on the map they can make other than that. There's nobody mid, so mid one's just farming. So the only real move they can make from there with the Axe set is to just storm you top. So a little bit of a misplay from Seedoy getting caught by that, but
another
still
rotation.
Having a reasonable start.
Roger is going to smoke up with Tame My Wild. As you said, they still have the Sonic Wave. He's going to be able to get the call, not expecting this turnaround. The Tame Walk goes off, and Shotzil will stay pretty healthy. The kick goes down. Do they actually have it disabled? They're going to try and throw everything they have, but it's not enough. Ferev, he stays alive ever so barely. Gets back to the fountain. A rotation fails this time around from Flipside.
Yeah, it's a pretty massive misplay from Roger right there. Not saving the kick, or at least using the stun. Instead of just the normal kick, so costing them that kill, and that's all their ults used, well, except for the Chrono. So
MP, that wasn't the right click you wanted to go for. Chronosphere just came back up, though. So they will make short work of MP this time around. A little bit of aggression at top lane gets Pylai die caught, and MP falls as well.
Yeah, just getting a little bit over aggressive. This early game definitely going a lot better than the last one. They have a little bit more breathing room, not quite so much as absolutely need to deathball. They have a little bit better of a scaling mid in the Quap.
They almost caught him. The Shuriken's not going to go out in time. Looks like Pylai Dai will still manage to finish off the kill, though. They get Seedoy, but they're going to lose their two supports for it after a couple of rotations from Flipside.
Yeah, they're really focusing on getting an early advantage in these lanes, rotating around. Anytime Seeker tries to make a move, pressure the Drow, pressure anybody, they turn around and make the most of it. Evoker's finally starting to catch up now after having a really, really rough early laning stage. He's level 8 now, so he has the 2 forts first, and he's going to start pressuring this tower, forcing heroes to be here. That's when everything starts getting pretty rough, because this Earth Spirit can't rotate it around anymore. They need at least one person here to defend this tower, or it will go down.
I can't believe the amount of time that like, it's 11 minutes in, and they're still sending that Lifestealer up to the top lane. I guess the lane's getting a bit easier for him as supports are rotating out. Obviously, the beginning of the lane was quite tough, but now he's got better sustain thanks to a little bit of Feast and some damage, as well as the Infest, I guess, to be able to get back. Bounty Hunter finds a kill on Roger. Was that even... Yeah, it was a Sunstrike use, so that was a combination kill.
I think he missed the Sunstrike. He was fighting with the Forge Spirit, and the Sunstrike whiffed a little bit. The Forge Spirit got him low enough where Puppy could burst him.
I'm surprised Puppy was able to do the kill alone. He will be caught, though, by Tame My Wilds, who does manage to get the successful Dust and a dominating spree for Queen of Pain. I mean, she's not a hero that you're going to see a whole lot in this patch, but... in order to be successful, she definitely needs to have a strong first 10 minutes, and it doesn't get much stronger than this. 4-0-1 so far.
Yeah, Flipside have definitely had a pretty good early laning stage, but this Invoker is farming up a lot. The Nakes having a decent game. Him and Drow sort of on par, both died a couple of times. Tanked some rotations, but this Invoker and Axe, pretty worrisome right now. Has the Vanguard and almost a blink on top of that at 12 minutes, so... pressure is mounting from Flipside, but figures are going to get equalized very quickly when Axe gets this blink.
Yeah, Flipside looks like they're hoping for just one more pickoff on the Axe before he can get that blink tagger. Unfortunately, Frev, I think he's kind of making that read. He's like, hey, they're putting the extra effort to try and gank me. He spends a little bit more time off map and in the jungle, which means his blink tagger timing will come potentially as a surprise to Flipside, and he also dodges that gank by going over to the Ancients, farming that. The blink dagger now up for Frev, plus level 11. He gets the right kind of spin for even just the infest damage pop out and a couple of right clicks. They will very easily bring any of these heroes down to the Culling Blade threshold.
Yeah, this is where things get sort of problematic. They know the Axe is farming a blink, but they haven't seen it yet. So you're sort of in that position where it's like, does he have it yet? You aren't sure if you can pressure or not. Joker has the Midas up now, so they definitely have a whole lot of potential to win these fights. Both sides do, but... it's definitely easier for Seeker to get an initiation, whereas Flipside, they only have the Chrono with him jumping in and the Blink Axe call, so things definitely a little scary right now.
The TP comes in, and Frev instantly goes for the call, stalled up by the Chronosphere as well as a Fiend's Grip, but the damage they're outputting may not be enough. Frev finally brought low by the pure damage combination of the Bane and the Queen of Pain. Puppy's gonna wrap around, though. He's going for Seedoid. They have the Invest pop out. That's gonna be your first of bounty kills. One for one trade-off on Kors. Tame My Wild goes down to the right clicks of Midwan. He gets enough. He's taking a lot of right-click damage from the Void, as well as his damage over time from the Earth Spirit, and will eventually fall because of that. Roger continues and gets a nice kick out. A lot of damage on the Puppy as well. They see him too. The vision's out. The dust popped on him, and they'll manage to get a third kill. Vanscore picks up the mega kill streak, and P's just hoping to be able to even out the score, though. Get the support kill of Roger, who unfortunately has absolutely no mana and only one stone to his name. So he goes ahead, calls it quits. A 3-for-3 exchange, but Secret keep their tier 1 tower alive.
Yeah, as well as I think one or maybe two of those are track kills, so definitely a Secret favorite exchange. And once again, the Drow going down. Super poor, not even the Dragonlance yet at 14 minutes. Sort of the same boat she was in last game. Just not really a position you want to be in, especially as a Drow versus an Axe. Heroes that can jump you, it's very, very problematic.
Now, Frev died in that last team fight, which is going to slow down his Blademail progression, but if they can start getting track kills for Frev, it can make a rapid progression to that item, which would be a big counter to the Draw Ranger, as well as even the magic damage coming out from the Queen of Pain. It looks like they're going to spot Tame My Wild as he blinks forward. Oh, looks like they don't quite have the vision on him. Rev is just one step away. Gets the call almost. Tame My Wild blinks himself away. Nice reactions from him. Once again, he's been doing okay all series long. It looks like they're going to be able to find Puppy. The relocate is coming in, though. They're going to try and fight this one out. Tame My Wild has the blink up. Oh, and a Fiend's Grip. That's going to be stopped out by Ferret, but he's immediately pushed back with a silence. A double stun goes down, buying Vanskor's space to stay ahead of Ferret. No Cooling Blade today. Ferret is just going to be kited around by Seedoy, who is now having to deal with the Cold Snap Forge Spirits combination coming out from the Invoker. Still, though, Flipside very clearly have won this fight. Invoker's forced to back away, and MP makes the long dive to find a creep wave, which he finally does so.
Yeah. Flipside is taking these fights exactly like they need to, surviving the initiation, super fast reaction time. Tame My Wild live there. And just turning it around with the Ice Arrow slows, the grip, all their kiting abilities. It's definitely how they need to play these fights, because if they get heroes bursted during the axe call, there's not really much they can do to take them the fight from there.
Kick away, MP pops the rage, turns, it's still going for Roger, but he's already down low with the Chronosphere's up. Oh no, Tame My Wild actually jumps into that one. He's got the ultimate though, and it looks like Puppy as well as the Lifesteal, they're both very dead, so Tame My Wild goes for a little bit more. He is going to be called up by the Axe though, maybe he blinked too far. The team trying to help him out, nice sleep, dodged a little bit of damage, and now they continue to kite. Ferev, a big nuke comes out, misses Pylai Dive, but it doesn't matter, they get that kill anyway. Ferev is bought down, half HP, hoping to be able to give the shot slow for staffed away, unable to get the Calling Blade, and now it's just left up to Mid One fighting up against Tame My Wild, who mans up, goes for this kill, will just barely be able to get it, but dies to the Forge Spirits in return. Mid One picks up the triple, but again, Flipside walk away the betters of the team fight.
Yeah, they just keep jumping in with these initiations, but not quite killing the person they are. They're jumping for nice stuns from Roger as well as sleeps. Man Square just stalling these initiations and being able to turn around with the ice slows, the daggers coming out nonstop. But Nakwap almost has the orchid, so it's gonna make this Wisp's life unenjoyable for sure.
11-20, 17 minutes in, you could see Flipside having taken some of these fights. Do manage to bring that track gold lead that Secret was getting, halting it and even getting a slight gold lead for now. Definitely winning out in experience by a larger margin, though.
Yeah, this Lifestealer, only the armlet right now, so once again, if they don't get the jump and kill heroes during their during the call or during like Cold Snap, something like that, then Squab is having the Orchid now. They can easily turn around this Lifestealer with no real way to get away whenever he's Orchid daggered up.
Secret, it seems like some of these engagements, say for example their choice to relocate up to the top lane, isn't really playing out for them too well. It seems like Flipside just kind of has their number. The kiting of the Queen of Pain, a Drow Ranger combined with the Chronosphere hold is making it pretty tough for Team Secret to actually make their way around in these fights. Do you think Team Secret should still be looking for these engagements and they're just not finding the right kind of initiations and they can do better in the future? Or do you think they should maybe slow down the game a little bit and try and just buy a little bit more time for Invoker to get some little bit more farm up, and Lifestealer can make a slight comeback too and just farm in the jungle?
I think
reload. Poor Roger doesn't make it out. He's just praying that the Roshan will take the kill. The sleep goes down, dodging the Sunstrike, but Lifestealer will still take the kill in the end. So a free pickup, relocate cost, but it's a track kill, so well worth it.
I think they definitely should still keep going for these pickoffs. But maybe a little farther away from towers, looking for people whenever they're pushed out. Looking for solo heroes instead of taking these large-scale teamfights. Because that's sort of like the best thing Flipside has right now, is taking these teamfights where they just kite around. They make them last a long time, they get a whole lot of ice arrows off a lot of screams, and take the fight that way. But if you can get pickoffs just on solo heroes by themselves, like this Quap firing up this top lane, and then get pickoffs that way, then it's definitely very advantageous for them.
Not a whole lot of vision out there for Flipside right now, and I'm sure they're very wary, despite having been winning some of these fights recently. They know the danger of this Lifestealer and Fest combination rather intimately, given what was game number two in this series, where Secret took the Slardar Lifestealer combination and won that game very heavily against Flipside. So they're playing pretty conservatively without the vision to be able to see that vehicle. Now they see him in mid. They've actually got the Orchid onto Forever right now, slowing him down. But they don't have any other heroes coming in soon, so I think Tame My Wild is just kind of poking, but not expecting too much out of that.
Yeah, Flipside learning their lesson from the last time they played against the Lifestealer, and just playing as a group non-stop, picking really good teamfight heroes to deal with it. So that they can actually just walk around and snipe heroes and not giving Secret these easy solo pickoffs, but looks like they're gonna go for the Roshan.
Yeah, trying to sneak that one in. Tame My Wild is tracked up, but hasn't made its way into the Roshan pitch yet, just yet. In fact, he's gonna jump forward, but he's right into the trap of Rev and MP. Get a Queen of Pain kill, and it now looks like Flipside's attempts at Roshing are gonna be completely dashed. Flipside trying to make a go of it, maybe because they saw the Invoker at top lane still, but without the Queen of Pain, that's probably not a great idea. Call goes out, Infest popped out, but pushback there of the Gus keeps them at bay from going on the Drow Ranger. Vanskor, it's kind of an island right now, hiding in the trees, but I doubt he'll be found anytime soon. Looks like Flipside still want to control this Roshan area, though. Maybe they're still going to try and go for it when Queen of Pain's back up.
Yeah, those kinds of mistakes where you just go a little too aggressive on Quap are very, very costly. It's a hero that you just die a couple of times, the hero just massively falls off because she's so squishy that if you're not ahead, that you know, you get caught one time by one disable, you just evaporate, and it'll be like that for the rest of the game most probably.
They've been spotted. Roger, he's going to have to make a roll out of here. Turns around, goes for the kick. Looks like Vanskorn may be caught. Forev managed to get a call onto him. Roger does go down. Forev, though, is going to be caught playing the price, though, for trying to catch that extra kill. Silence up. Uh-oh, looks like poor MP. He may be going down. He has to armlet toggle a little bit. Does manage to get the rage off. Sleep goes down. Buying Tame My Wild a second or two. Sunstrike will land on him, taking a good amount of damage, but he still managed to blink away from the engagement. Secret bouncing around. It's going to be up the mid one to try and change this one. As you can see, a third hero is going to go down the Chronosphere, catching Puppy mid one, unable to find an opening for an extra kill. Flipside have two cores up plus a Bane. That looks to me like enough for them to be able to probe at Roshan.
Yeah, they went on different targets there. They were chasing down the Earth Spirit Rev, having the wrong idea, thinking that they were near him, going a little too far in, and then their only initiator being down. They sort of chip away a couple of pickoff kills with some nice plays, but they're going to get the Roshan in the end, so a really nice exchange for Flipside.
Yeah, you have to wonder if, first of all, if Vanskor didn't have a Force Staff, you know, to be able to get away, because they had the vision, right? They saw at least the Earth Spirit here. They thought, okay, we're going to be able to get a free support pick off, but him being able to Force Staff down that cliff and be able to get away from that situation made all the difference, and that just comes down to some of those early engagements. The fact that Flipside were the ones coming out on top meant that this Bane got himself such an early item. He's so farmed for a support like this. You know, what is normally looked at as kind of like a hard fight position, that's actually the Earth Spirit operating that role now. He's only sitting at 1700, but our Bane, big old 5k net worth on him.
Yeah, those early fights where they just overextended a little bit, MP getting a little too greedy for kills. Now it doesn't even have his Deso yet, so the net worth of Flipside definitely very, very healthy. They just have to keep making sure they don't get caught by these axe ganks, and if they don't, then their teamfight is going to slowly, surely become very, very good. Already very strong with the Chrono, the Bolt, all their spells. Just sort of hard Radiant's for Secret to take these 5-on-5 fights.
Well, there is potentially a game changer. We finally have the Blade Mail out for the axe, so the initiation is going to be so much stronger than it was before. Seedoy is leading the charge here on this tier 1 tower push. He's got the Aegis. He wants to be the target of the Axe Lifestealer call. You could see Shachilo is sitting here on the side ready to counter-initiate at a moment's notice.
Yeah, having the Drow Aegis is not really... You can't really jump in. You have to use the Rage and the Lifestealer to burst him down and then get gripped, crawl out, and turn everything around.
This Orchid, it certainly paid off quite well, but when we look at, maybe it's just because Queen of Pain really hadn't invoked too much, but say Storm's here, for example, he's another very common mid hero that picks up Orchid, but he always goes for the Bloodstone first. What is it about the Queen of Pain? Is it just because you're so focused on being able to control the tempo of this game that you need to be able to go the Orchid first in a game like this?
Yeah, it's just sort of the fact that Quaff just isn't a hero that scales that well late game. Her sort of her toolkit, she's very focused. She has like a big long cooldown ult, so you want to get aggressive early on and keep that ult on cooldown, always using it for kills, sort of like the Chronosphere. Where Storm has like ball lightning that allows him to scale really well into the late game, and still do damage because of overcharge.
Oh, Ferev tries to make this initiation by himself. The sleep goes down on Tame on Wild, and now the Fiend's Grip onto Ferev. Solo YOLO play from Ferev does not pay out any dividends, as just gives away a free kill to Vanskor, who's now on a monster kill streak. Jesus. Somebody's out of the meta. He's doing quite well for himself. The Gust isn't actually going to catch the relocating heroes, though mid one actually jumps forward to catch Roger, seeing if he could get the extra kill because they know they have the Drone Ranger dead. That is just the Aegis, though, and Secret know that the rest of Flipside are on their way. It's going to be Shotchlo trying to lead the way with his Blink Dagger and a Time Walk to catch the Chronosphere, and he does get an MP. He's going to be the target. Puppy walks into it as well. They manage to get the Orchid onto MP, ensuring his death. Puppy still trying to make his way out, though, but with a gem in hands and now the disable to keep Puppy in place, they easily claim a third kill. A pickoff on Axe turns so much worse for Team Secret, and all they can hope is that Mid One can put the pressure on the side lanes to keep these heroes back. It looks like Mid One even thinking about going for Vanskor. But it's a bit dangerous. With a Blink Yules, he's got the tools to kill a support, but a Bane is a hero that would punish you heavily if he does manage to get that Nightmare out. Call for Rev is going to make the solo play once again. The Culling Blade's not enough. A Sunstrike doesn't land in time. Shotchlo was dead if that Sunstrike was just a second earlier, but a bit too late for Mid One.
Yeah, pretty unfortunate. It's sort of like the mind games to go they've gone through in this game are pretty interesting. Having the last game where they get stomped pretty hard, having the Drow strat, coming back and picking it again, Secret going for the same heroes, but knowing that they just make a few key mistakes, they can play the lineup a little bit better and still win the game with the same Drow Ranger strat. And not the exact same heroes, but a very similar strategy, and just playing it a lot better this time, and the game being slightly in Flipside's favor, still very close, but in a better position as their heroes are better whenever they're, you know, behind or even compared to last game. Just try
and poor MP. Even just the laning phase setup changes the game quite a bit, where MP, you know, what was it last game? They had the Juggernaut, right, as the active core. This time around, it's the Lifestealer. And this guy still is just sitting on Armlet. They haven't had the successful pickoffs that they did last time around against the Drone Ranger lineup, and it's very clearly being a pain in MP's ass. He isn't able to make the comeback and get that nice Desolator timing around 20, 25 minutes, 26 minutes. He's only sitting at just a Mithril Hammer and 1,300 gold.
Yeah. But Yules now as well on Quap. Vax does jump in, can Yules him, stop him from attacking him, so the spins don't come out and just help his teammates from getting bursted. He's really the only one that's there. It's still very, very easy to burst. That is a, you know, high priority target. So if they don't find this Quap, fights are pretty difficult because they have mechanisms to save everybody else with the Yules, the Nightmare, and just counter initiating. So.
The smoke up by Flipside, and they will sweep on through the ancient area. Maybe be able to catch someone. It looks like instead they're just going to go for a backdoor on that tier 1 tower. Not trying to delay too much. I like how these two blinking heroes, though, always operating as mobile wards, while the Drow Ranger finds the prey in the tier 1.
Yeah, scouting around for the wards with the gem. Really, really nice early gem pickup. Cutting down on their vision. They are so reliant on knowing where the heroes are so they can get these axe jumps to take the fights, but without that, it's very easy for Flipside to get the better initiation.
Yeah, and it's not just knowing where the heroes are at, right? It's about knowing where the heroes are at and if that hero that you're going to jump on has any backup behind them, because they've got really good counters, especially now with some of the item pickups by the Queen of Pain, like that Yule Scepter you mentioned, and then the Faces Void with his Blink Dagger Chronosphere. If you make the right kind of call and fest jump, you're just putting two of your cores into a Chronosphere, potentially.
Yeah, for sure. It's very, very hard to play the game like that, but that's why the Void pick coming in really, really nice, just sort of stopping them, Secret, from making any aggressive moves, or that many aggressive moves, because they're always scared of Flipside being S5, which they have been S5 quite a bit of the game, but still farming decently and keeping the game very close. Dire's middle tower is under
attack. Secret, they see couple of heroes at bottom lane, I think. Or maybe they haven't. Maybe Flipside has just been hiding behind the tower. Queen of Pain shows herself now, but Secret already set up at the top lane. They would clear through this jungle, maybe set up for a tier 2 push, anticipating Flipside to go for the bottom tier 2. See if they can make a trade-off without actually having a fight.
Yeah, mid one is definitely Secret's bright spot right now. 16k net worth, has the Ags online. 5k gold as well, so there's a lot of teamfight potential, but this Lifestealer is seriously a liability at this point. Only 8k net worth, can't even burst heroes that well anymore. A lot of armor on the drow, the Yules on the top, and if that hero can't burst heroes down, especially versus the lineup with the ice arrows, the bane disables, earth spirit stuff, if he doesn't kill people during rage, he just gets kited super easily and doesn't have that big of a game impact.
Well, Flipside Tactics don't actually get the better of this exchange so far. They just took one tier 2 for 2 as Secret pushed in both mid as well as top lane without really putting anybody in potential danger. But Flipside Tactics looks like they're going to try and poke high ground and at least force Secret back inside their base. A little map control for themselves. Failing an initiation from Secret though, they may just take a full tier 3.
Yeah, taking that over that range group with the HUD and putting it into the base so they could see when people were TPing in, if the Axe was there yet, so he could get some free hits in. Really nice small play there. They were able to get that tower down, so now pushing the base much easier. The Drow still full HP.
It's gonna be harder to go. Chronosphere actually goes out. Looks like they caught Puppy. They did not manage to get Rev though. He still managed to blink forward, but it doesn't matter as now MP pops out, but it's straight into the Fiend's Grip. Vanscore once again in masterful position of this game will manage to counter Team Secret's aggression. Two of the cores down, one of them has buyback. MP does up though, and this may be Flipside taking a late range of Rax. We're gonna see Flipside actually trying to retreat now after the buyback of Rev. He managed to get the call onto Roger, doesn't get the Culling Blade this time around. They get one support, but they need a whole lot more. Seedoy, he's stunned at the side! They managed to get the Ghoul Scepter, and that's going to be a Drow Ranger. A big pickoff. If it was just Roger for the buyback on Ferev, that would have been well worth it for Flipside, but now they've lost the Void, they lost the Earth Spirit, and finally the Drow Ranger. The push is still coming in. The Melee Racks need some help, though. Looks like they will be there in time to prevent the Melee Racks from going down to the creeps.
Yeah, also losing the gem off the Void, so huge there. Secret's actually going to be able to move out, get some of those wards down, and actually have space to farm on the map again, and, you know, maybe set up for these fights. The Lifestealer is still dying early on in that fight, so it's still mid one being the very, very farmed hero and everyone else much poorer.
Mid one, don't do it! Don't do it! Vanscore's here to counter you! Oh no, he fell for the bait. Mid one tries to go for the solo kill on Tame My Wild. Now mid one has to make a desperate escape, but he's good. No countervision is out from Flipside. He gets a nice tornado before the disables come out. He's still going to try and fight this one. He's got some backup coming in. He baits a little bit. Now the relocate in. Frev goes for the call, misses out. Now he's orking it up. Unable to stop Roger from retreating. Tame My Wild takes a good amount of magic damage. Looks like Roger's still going to be the pick, though. Secret. Somehow, mid one went from a terrible position, falling into a trap set by Flipside, to actually being able to get a pick thanks to some quick reactions with the Invoker.
Yeah, I didn't quite have the Fiend's Grip up, still on cooldown for 20 or 30 more seconds, so no real way to lock him down. Earth Spirit not near, so just sort of waddles away. The Ghost Walk comes back in. Really nice read there to realize, hey, I can go back in, we can get a free kill. And track gold, every little bit helps.
Yeah, it seems like even the team was a little bit surprised by the aggression from Midwan. They were making their rotation in with Ferev and MP, but Highlight Dice relocate was a little bit slow.
It was also more on the defensive side, not so deep in.
Oh, the call comes out. They're going to go straight for Seedoy, but a Chronosphere is here, locking down two cores. But can they actually keep Seedoy alive? They managed to get the Orchid out, preventing the Culling Blade, but MP still gets the damage. Nice tornado coming on through. It's going to be able to land a huge meteor onto the Bane, as well as the Queen of Pain. Queen of Pain blinks out, but Roger's left in the tail end of that damage will still go down. A relocate forward, but Shachlo, thanks to his mobility of Blink and Time Walk, will get away until Midwan says hello. He's got the Yule Scepter. Cold Snap preventing the Time Walk away for a second. He still gets the distance, but Secret just keep on trucking on through. They tank the tier 3 tower, be damned, they go for a jump away, but it's still, the shuriken follows through. Midwan claims that kill and jumps for even more. Tame my wild right in front of his fountain, though. He'll fight mid one. That orchid still, though. Secret come out big. They're going to be able to get the tier 3 tower. Nobody's going to be back up for another 10 seconds. And still another 20 left on the Drow Ranger. And even then, they'd have to buy back on the Faceless Void. 15 seconds to have their full 5-man crew up to contest this push. It's looking like Secret will get the lane of Rax.
Yeah, when the Drow Ranger falls, they really just don't have that much damage. The Quap only having her spells, and they all have high enough HP counts where they can't get bursted down by just the spells anymore, so... no real damage inside the Chrono.
Melee Rax, is Secret sticking around too long? They've got the ranged as well. MP, he starts making his way out. Flipside, we're hoping to be able to delay his retreat long enough for the Faceless Void to come into the fight, but not going to happen. Range Rax stays alive, just 50 HP. Either way, though, the important Rax is down for Secret.
Yeah, Tigma Wild actually going for a Dragonlance. You can sort of see how they're feeling. They know that as the game goes later and later, Secret's eventually going to get items on their cores, mid one being super farmed, and they're just going to be able to kill this Drow with the Axe Calls. You can't avoid Axe Calls forever, you know, and you can't play perfect. So, trying to go into more damage items, but just a little bit too late at this point. They really, really need to get perfect initiations and have Seedoil live, but it's hard versus the Axe Calls, the Invoker spells, the Lifesteal are just running at you non-stop.
23 to 29, 35 minutes in, almost a 10k lead here from Secret, about 8,000 net worth lead right now, and a 2,500 experience lead. For them, they've turned this game to their favor quite sharply, with a couple of pickoffs and a push into mid lane, and they look to actually close out this game if they get the right kind of initiation here at bottom. But flip side, they do seem kind of aware of the potential jump here. Seedoil pops his Manta. That's just going to be more targets for Fereb. He does not have the Lifestealer inside of him, it looks like. Seedoil pops the BKB and now turns with the Fiend's Grip and kills Fereb farther down. Hops out, but straight into the Chronosphere he goes. MP, a bad time to leave, as now he's going to be caught by yet another ult. And now the Yule Scepter on Pylai Dai stops the relocate as he attempted to save MP. Flipside will get a third kill. Secret were so close to being able to close out this game potentially, but now they've given fresh life to Flipside.
Yeah, Rev just going a little too over aggressive and getting the really, really nice Chrono on the Lifestealer on the back end. Everybody just being too far away and not being able to blow up the Drow within the duration. It has a BKB now, so if they don't kill him during that time, get him low enough to where he can be right to click down, he sort of just falls.
Another time walk away. Vanskor blinks forward. They don't have any counter vision, though. Actually, they've got a dust on Roger, but mid one, far and well away. I was just about to say, come on, Flipside, get with the story. You know mid one. After a fight is over like that, nobody is safe. If mid one's still alive, you guys break apart. He's always going to go for one of those extra picks. Mid one's going to go run straight into the Tame Y Wild and immediately pops out the Port Spears, unable to get the Cold Snap down in time. He gets Orchid first, but now the call comes down. Culling Blade sure to come in, but the Silence first, and they will get the Queen of Pain, but not the extra movement speed to be able to save the Invoker. Fereb is eventually beaten to a pulp as Seedoil comes in with the Manta, but it cost them two kills already. Two cores for a core and a support, not a bad trade-off for Flipside, but they're not in a position where they can actually take control of this game. In fact, mid one going for a buyback here. That is an odd one, especially since there is no buyback on for Rev. Everything to be able to ensure that they can get this Roshan into their control while the Chronosphere is down, I guess.
Yeah, it is worth it whenever you do that, because then you have the Roshan, so it's not like you're in danger of dying and them having this win condition anymore. And you don't want Flipside to take it, because that is one of their only roots back into this game, is getting the Roshan, so you can't jump the Drow anymore, and Secret sort of have a don't have a way to initiate these fights, but with the Aegis, they can still jump the Drow and blow her up, jump the other heroes, and the game remains in their control.
Yeah, nicely, that was a very quick decision by Secret to be able to see that opening and be like, hey, they don't have Chronosphere, they won't be able to contest Roshan, let's buy back, get the Aegis into the hands of Midwan, and that just takes away that potential opportunity for Flipside, and having a second life in the Invoker in a team fight, that certainly doesn't hurt either. That being said, Shachlo does pick up a fresh item after so long operating on just a Blink Dagger and a Vlad's. You finally get a Manta, so a little bit of damage coming out from this offlaner. From Flipside, they certainly need it as they are coming a little bit lacking here at 38 minutes with a Drow Ranger and Queen of Pain operating as their main cores. They're inevitably going to start dropping off around this time.
Yeah, an interesting pickup. The Lifesteal are actually going for a Halberd, so another, as this Drow's BKB ticks lower and lower and lower, eventually going to have a really nice way to shut her down. And also, a lot of the damage on Flipside is physical. The Drow's right clicks, the Quap getting some damage in because of the Drow aura. And the Void as well only does damage through right clicks, so a little bit unconventional, but increases survivability a whole lot and makes it much harder to kite him.
Yeah, unlike the, I mean, it's a cheap source of evasion, right? MP, he's certainly not drowning in gold, that's for sure. He's had a tough game pretty much all game, starting from the laning phase, and hasn't really made that full progression into a leading core, so having some cheap survivability is sure to help in the team fights that are important right here, right now. 39 minutes in, Team Secret, they're pushing forward pretty aggressively. Violet die. He's actually the one to push out the top lane while the rest of the heroes are off map. They've got the infested Ferev Axe sweeping over into the mid lane, seeing if he can catch Seedoy. They do have him. They are going to be able to make the jump and instantly kill Seedoy. The response is just not fast enough from Flipside. They finally do get the Chronosphere, and they're looking to be able to bring down these heroes, but do they actually have enough damage to relocate out? And they're going to be able to keep MP alive. Maybe not Ferev. He's orking it up. A little bit more damage from Tame My Wild, and he does live. The magic damage coming out is not going to be good enough. They bottle him back up. And Flipside, they didn't actually lose Seedoy. How the hell did Seedoy get out of there? What?
Yeah, he was like 13 HP or something. He got slept and then forced away BKB to the Dire to kill him and barely lived.
I just saw his health bar disappear during the sleep, so I thought, oh, he must be dead. What a save there from the Bane Vanskor. Very clutch, as that obviously would have been a huge win for Secret. They had gotten away, big ultimates blown, and Drow Ranger kill up, but as it is, looks like they're only going to get the tier 3 tower for now. Flipside are able to hold ground. But the Chronosphere is down, and Team Secret may still try and force this fight.
Yeah, Axe getting bot, so Secret is very, very down to push here. The Invoker still is Aegis, so he can just sort of walk up on the high ground with these buildings. Not much Flipside can do about it.
Chronosphere not up for another 40 seconds. No Fiend's Grip either. They're going to go for a sleep onto Ferev, trying to slow down this push. The melee Rax is almost gone here. The Glyph is eventually going to wear out. The regen's not fast enough. The melee Rax goes down to one swipe from MP and a right click from the Invoker. Secret, happy with that exchange. The bottom lane pushing in. It looks like they're going to back themselves up now. One melee Rax up once again.
Yeah, mid one being cheeky, just sort of getting in their heads, messing with this Quap, throwing Sunstrikes. Really just been very, very flashy this game, making a lot of cool plays, getting some pickoffs, and just being a thorn in Flipside's side.
Oh, the relocate in. They've got a Chronosphere in just one more second, but Shotslo, he jumps in for the time walk, won't be able to get the Chronosphere out now, tries desperately, but the Cold Snap is too much. MP, he takes out the Void, and now no Chronosphere to be able to hold down that Invoker means MP is just able to go straight for Roger, and Flipside, they've blown some serious ultimates, as well as now a BKB out from Seedoy. They're rapidly trying to retreat, but Ferev is hot in the case, mid 1-2. He throws out a Blind Tornado, unable to catch the members of Flipside, but you know, Secret, they see weakness right now. They're going to try and take that next objective. Unfortunately, the Tier 2 is still alive at bottom lane, so they can't take that final lane of Rax. So instead, they'll just get the range tracks at top lane and wait for the push on bottom.
Yeah, but one also sort of weakening these Tier 4s a little bit, so just standing around in their base, almost taunting them, starting their dominance, and keeping Flipside in the base, not too much they can do right now. The Invoker still having Aegis, having the Octarine core, so just a flurry of spells that he has at his disposal.
Deeper and deeper down the rabbit hole we go, or maybe it's actually going up, sorry. Secret up to 10k net worth lead, forgot their Radiant side. Secret only holding a slight experience lead, but again, Team Secret have the better late game, right? So those numbers mean all the more when you consider Secret. Right, good control of this game, have two lanes of Rax, full lanes down, and are just left with a pesky tier 2 tower before they can siege the bottom lane. That being said, Their Aegis is now worn out. They're still going to try and find the initiation. They just warded up. Shotchill immediately kills that ward, but Ferev, oh, that was a whiff there. He tried to go for the blink call. The Tono does manage to land, but he still managed to relocate out. Bounty Hunter's down. He drops his gem. MP with the double damage tries to go for Cedo, but the damage is too much. This fight inside the jungle turns well into the hands of Flipside as they catch two and going to be able to get a third now as Pylai die, unable to do anything about his relocate. So Flipside win the defensive fight. They can now push forward, try and be on the aggressive, control the mid and top lanes. Are they going to be able to push for that much more? Can they force out any buybacks or even at least take a tier 2 mid? We'll have to see.
Yeah, super nice read from Flipside and Shotchlo being up on that hill with the gem. So whenever they see those heroes, Ferev missing the call, the blink might have been cooldown or he might have just misclicked or something. But wasting his call on the two-man chrono, the relocate out saving Ferev, but Pylai paying the price and MP as well, just going in a little bit late, sort of some miscommunication, and Flipside are going to get some buildings off of it.
Yep, tier 2 mid is going to be the first victim here of Flipside. Maybe the only one. It looks like they're going to try and poke at high ground with Manta Illusions, but of course, with 10 more seconds left on both the Wisp and the Lifestealer, they're not actually going to put any heroes in danger. Flipside back up to their side of the map.
Yep. A BKB now as well on mid one, so much more difficult to kill. The Drow's, the Cold Arrows and the Shadow Strikes, the Earth Spirit Disables, not near as effective on the Invoker, so they're gonna have to commit the Chrono or the Fiend Script to kill him, otherwise he's just gonna run rampant. And the Cold Snap has really, really been working wonders in these fights, keeping the Void from getting the Chrono off.
Do you think mid one is public enemy number one for Flipside? Do you think he's the target that they should be looking to try and Chrono on burst down first?
I don't really know if Flipside can be the aggressors. I think they have to wait for Secret to make mistakes like they did before and counter-initiate, because if they do jump in first, the Wisp will be able to save the hero probably. And if not, then they can just jump the heroes and make themselves known, because if the Drow shows herself, then everyone just bull rushes her. So I think they have to wait for Secret to make mistakes or botch initiation like they did before and play around that.
Flipside are going to smoke up. Are they going to wrap around and try and catch Secret when they go for this tier 2? Not even wrapping. They're just moving straight forward. Secret, though, have already backed out. Not sure if they made the read on that smoke or if they just want to take a bit more time to farm and wait for the next Roshan. We'll have to see. Flipside, though, are going to push forward. Double blinks out. Flipside are not able to get any damage and completely whiff the Seek and Destroy mission here from Roger, trying to find anybody here on the side trees. But now Flipside, they're going to be the ones who could be initiated on. Shotchlo's going to try and take out that ward, but it's going to be Seedoy. He's initiated on Ferev. Vanskor does manage to save him, though, in the Fiend's Grip. That's the mistake they were looking for. With the Chronosphere onto two, they can go for so much more. Pylai Dai tethers into the Chronosphere. Tornado just trying to disrupt this damage as best as possible. But MP still in trouble, pops a Rage, turns, and fights up against the Queen of Bane, but he had to blink up. Mid one, he's the one manning up. He goes straight for Cedo with the disarm still up. Yule Scepter, and all of a sudden he realizes this is no longer a man fight he can take. Flipside control the Invoker and bring him down. Mid one goes down for the first time in such a long, long time. 100 seconds down. Flipside, there is a real opening that they can possibly take some control of this game. They're going to go first for Roshan and Secret. Oh, they're going to fight this one. Puffin's leading the way, but Ferev, he's got the double call. He's going to be able to grab Cedoy. Asleep goes down, saving Cedoy's life, but he's already so low. He pushes them back, tries to get the distance. The heal goes down. Eventually, though, he will drop mass buybacks.
Good
coming out.
Night.
Flipside, bop three, and one comes out from Secret, as well as two, actually. Mid one also buying back there. This next fight, if we have a fight around the Roshan, this next fight could be final for both teams. Yule Scepter catching Tame My Wild. He has no BKB. He's going to be caught by the call. Vanskor saves him once again with a sleep. It doesn't stop. Deafening Blast, but he blinks himself away. A time dilation from Shotchlo, and now he jumps forward, hoping to be able to catch MP, but the Rage is still up. MP turns, fights, and the time walk away from the Faceless Void will call a short break. On this team fight, they have to back up and deal with their tier 4 towers that are currently being pushed in from top and middle lane. Team Secret, they have the opening to go Roshan now if they want to. there's a chance they may get caught in the pit, so instead they're gonna go for a smoke and push through into the secret shop. Seedoy sitting there, he's gonna pop the smoke, but they already managed to get the call. Attempted Mantle Dodge isn't going to make it, and Seedoy, he's gone. And already, Chronosphere is actually coming back up. They actually fight this one, Chronosphere into two, but Queen of Pain nowhere to be found. They get a Fiend's Grip onto MP, but they need some physical damage, and they just don't have it. Flipside, stop. Cold Snap onto Vanscore brings quick stopper there. To the Fiend's Grip, Vanscore trying to make his way back to the Tier 3 tower after sleep, but Midwan catches him, blinks forward with the Ice Wall, 80 seconds down on two cores, and it looks like Tame My Wild may be falling as well. Yule Scepter has a blink up in a second, Feref unable to get the call, but the slow is still there. Midwan, the Beast, a triple kill, almost gets the quad, a teammate takes it in front of him, but still, Midwan jumping forward, dominating this fight, and Team Secret go straight for the Tier 4s with no more buybacks left on Flipside. They call it GG. Congratulations to Team Secret, who will be one of the European teams qualifying for the Dota Pit LAN Final.
Yeah, Midwan really, really showing off his prowess this series, playing extremely well every game. The TA game is a little rough for Secret as a whole, and
a nice climactic end to our game number four is Team Secret. They've been nicely controlling that game for a while, but it all came down to that big buyback team fight.